ushers for the West. Okay, let's pray over it. Lord, we thank you once again for your love. Lord, we thank you for your grace, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that you bless us, Lord, that we can give back unto you tonight, Lord. God, I pray that you bless this offering to the furtherance of your kingdom, and we give you all the praise, and we give you all the glory for it. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
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 Alrighty, so as y'all know, Pastor, he's in Togo, so I am not pastor, nor will I ever claim to be pastor. I am nothing like Pastor Chad. He is his own person, but I am also my own person. Okay. And so just as God has given Pastor Chad a ministry, he's also given me. And so simply tonight, I'm going to teach you the word as God gave it to me. I'm going to preach it to you the way he gave it to me. And so, no matter how long it takes, if you have to leave, you have my permission.
Amen.
Not that you need it, but you have it in you. So, with that, we're going to go ahead and get started. All right. So, we have a revival coming up. February
6th.
16th. Is that it? Is it revival? 16th. 16th?
Somewhere.
Okay. We have a revival somewhere in February. Pastor has asked us to fast. And so, of course, I have never really been one to fast. I decided that I was going to fast. And I can definitely see the benefits of this fast in my own personal life, just as many of you can, probably as well. But I do want to make this statement when it comes to fasting. And it's in the form of a question, and you can answer this for yourself. How prepared are you? How prepared are you for the presence of God? That is a question I want you to think about. How prepared are you? Are you fasting? Are you doing enough in your fast? Are you fasting something that ultimately takes up your time to where it's almost as it's a hindrance, that it hurts you to do it? Because if you're not, you're not ready.
That's good.
But if you are fasting something, my next question to you is this. I asked you if you were prepared, but are you also prepared to use what God's given you?
That's good. That's good.
You see, we look at God, and you look at the Bible, and one of the main words, I'm not going to say the main word, the most used word to explain God, the most used adjective is holy. Mm-hmm. That's who God is.
Yep.
Now, I'm not saying by any means that's the most important one, because all the characteristics of God, there's not one that you can place above another. But I can't say this. The word holy is the most commonly used word to describe God.
Yep.
So what does this tell us? Amen. That being holy is an important aspect of Christianity to us.
Amen.
That being holy is the foundation by which, one of the foundations by which God reigns and by which He reigns in us.
That's good, yes.
Yeah. And so tonight, I'm going to teach on God's holiness.
Amen.
And so, we'll have the scriptures on the screen. But if you have your Bibles, you can turn to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. And so during this time, we have the people of Israel. And the people of Israel, simply put it, they were stubborn. They were hard-headed. No matter what they wanted, or no matter what God wanted, it wasn't going to happen. No matter what God told them, they weren't going to listen. The scriptural reference in that, you can find that in verse 9. But for that, we're just going to focus on verse 3. And it says this. This is talking about the angels. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of His glory." So at this time, like I mentioned, this is a time of spiritual decay for the Israelites. For they were not in the spiritual mindset that they should have been in. But yet, that doesn't take away anything from God. It doesn't matter what the people are like, but it matters what God is like. And so these angels, they're looking to God and they're saying, holy, holy, holy. This is pointing out the important aspect of holiness.
Good.
Of how holy God truly is. For to repeat in the Bible is a very important thing because it's saying, hey, you need to understand this. And so if the angels are saying that God is holy, 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 it must mean that the holiness of God is important.
Amen.
And so in this is the call of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 6 is mainly focuses the call of Isaiah. And so Isaiah is being called by God in chapter 6. And what we need to recognize from this is that the angels are saying this about God, and they're saying this in front of Isaiah. And so they're trying to get Isaiah's attention to recognize the importance of God's holiness. And so you continue reading throughout Isaiah chapter 6, and it's Isaiah recognizing how holy God is and how unholy he is. For he recognizes himself that he is a man that is unclean. That without the holiness of God, there's nothing he can do. But it's through the holiness of God that his ministry is going to flourish.
Amen.
That he is going to be called. And so, throughout this teaching, we're going to realize that. But one of the things is, God is calling Isaiah to be set apart. To be different than the people of Israel. For though they're in spiritual decay, God is calling Isaiah to bring them out. And you continue reading, and God even tells Isaiah, you're going to speak the word to these people, but they're not going to listen. You're going to speak the word to these people, but they're not going to understand. And so, probably get an idea of what Isaiah's thinking of. He's probably thinking, why? Why speak it if they're not going to listen? Why? What's the importance? What reason is there to speak this? And it's because though all people won't hear, some will.
That's good. Yeah.
And so we can even go further into this. We look at Moses in Exodus chapter 19. And just a heads up, we'll also refer to Moses later. So just keep that in mind. But we'll look at an example of holiness and what God is trying to do to us through it. And so Exodus chapter 19 with verse 10. And the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. For to consecrate someone means to prepare them both spiritually and morally. To prepare them to meet God. And so the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and prepare them both physically and spiritually to meet him today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day. Because on the day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. So the act of washing, when we look at washing of the clothes, washing of the garments, the act of washing is almost like that of purification. In which I'm going to prepare myself spiritually to see God.
Amen.
And so God is giving Moses his command, consecrate the people, wash the people's garments, that they may be prepared for me, for I am coming.
That's good.
I am coming to you. My holiness is coming to you. My presence is coming to you. Yes. So prepare for it. Verse 12. Put limits for the people around the mountain. For that's where Moses is going. You skip to verse 14. After Moses has gone down the mountain to the people, he consecrated them. And they washed their clothes. So they're doing what God had commanded them to do. And then he said to the people, prepare yourselves for the third day. Abstain from sexual relations. For on the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning with a thick cloud over the mountain. And a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God. And they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord had descended on it in a fire. The smoke billed up from it like a smoke from a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently. And you look at even some Hebrew translations of that verse and says, in replace the whole mountain, it'll say, and all the people trembled violently. And so God is revealing himself to Moses. Consecrate the people. Prepare the people. What does Moses do? He prepares the people. He consecrates them. But this is where we get to. Though Moses consecrated the people, they could not ascend up the mountain.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
And there's a reason for it. Because they were still stuck in their idolatry.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That they were not prepared morally for God.
Good.
Thank you.
You see, it didn't matter the preparation that was going to be put into it. For if their hearts were not into it, they weren't going to see God.
Right, amen.
But Moses was prepared. He was prepared spiritually, morally, physically, and any other kind of lead you can think of. And so because of it, Moses gets to ascend up the mountain of God. Now this mountain is covered in the cloud.
Smoke.
Yeah. It is covered in the fire of God. Because Moses was prepared for it. Moses had prepared the people. Moses had prepared himself. And God said, if you do this, I will reveal myself to you. My presence will be revealed to you. And that's exactly what he did. So God offered himself to the people. He offered his presence to them, but they didn't get to see because they were not deemed holy. And so I'm going to be like Pastor Chad. I'm going to start writing that before he becomes
poor. I love it.
And no sight of the Lord equals no presence.
That's good.
And to reiterate this statement, we can even look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. And it simply tells us this: make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord.
Good.
So to be holy, one of the benefits of being holy is that you will live in peace. And if we can live with peace with one another, then we will see the side of the Lord. So my question to you, and before I go further with this, I ask a lot of questions. I ask a lot of questions. So I'm going to get you thinking about it. I'm going to get you thinking and worried about it. So, how much peace are you living in? Is there peace in your Because you see, God offered himself on the mountain. The mountain was filled with his presence. And his presence is peace. It's holy. And like I said, holiness equals peace. So how much peace do you have in your life? Yes, we all go through troubles. We all go through circumstances. That's called being a Christian. But if there is not a way for you to have peace through those trials, are you really living a Christian life?
Come on.
Are you whole? Are you walking in holiness of God?
That's right.
For he has granted us access to his presence. He has granted us access to his holiness. For in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, but we do see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a little while, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. How did God offer his holiness to us? He offered it through Jesus.
Yes.
And because of that, Jesus offers himself unto us He brought himself into the flesh and said, I'm going to live just like you. I'm going to walk just like you. Talk just like you. Just like you. And I'm going to show you the example of holiness. And this is what you are to follow. You are to follow my example. The same example I gave to Moses to tell the people. That example is how we're to live. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, it says, and we all who with unveiled faces reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory which comes from the Lord. So by recognizing the nature of the Lord, by recognizing the holiness of the Lord, we are made in his likeness. We are made in his image. We find that at the very beginning. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, God made man in his own image. Man and woman, he created. So we know that we are made in the image of God. But there's a difference between being formed by God and being made by God. And the difference is this. To be formed by God is for God to make something and bring life to it. But then, to be made by God is this. Not only are you formed, but you're also implementing the characteristics of God. You're implementing the nature of God inside of you. See, I can go back to Pastor Chad's preachings on John chapter 17. Mm-hmm. For he's all taught us this. John chapter 17, verses 1 through 6. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that you may know that they know you, the only true God, Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. For I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Yes. For I revealed you to those whom you have gave me out of this world. For they were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. And so God, he's praying about the disciples in this case. And so one of the things that we need to look at is that if the holiness of God is not evident in us, then it's time for you to check yourself.
Amen. Good. Yeah.
It is time for you to check where you are at with God.
Amen.
What is more important to you? Power or his presence? Power or his presence? What's more important to you? TV or his
work?
Food? Or the fruit of God, the manna from heaven. What is more important to you? For God brought his angels down to earth that his holiness may be revealed to us. And in verse 1, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. I'll put it in this terms. Father, glorify me, that I may glorify you.
That's right.
So what does the glorify mean? And this is stuff that Pastor Chad has preached before, has taught before, so I'm just going to reiterate. To glorify is to reveal the character and nature of.
Right.
And so, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. In other terms, God, reveal your nature to me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Reveal your nature to me, that I may reveal your nature to others.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what Jesus is praying. Jesus, glorify me. Reveal your nature to me that I may reveal your nature to my people. And in the same way as God is praying this, Jesus is praying this. Jesus is also calling us to do the same. For Jesus gave us the command to go. Not to wait. Not to stand still. Not to sit down in a recliner, watch TV, listen to the radio, eat. No. He said go. And because he's calling us to go, what are we going to do? What is that in which we are to go to do? And that is to walk in his holiness.
Amen.
For Jesus revealed his true self and character and his nature to those whom God had given him. For God's glory is the revelation of his character and the revelation of his presence.
Yeah.
Good thing.
And so through this revelation, we're able to see him in his greatness. So what is a revelation? If we look at the Greek word for revelation, I'll go ahead and write it for some of you notators. I'm running out of room. Apocalypse. And this is what it means. To unveil, reveal, and uncover. The lifting up of a curtain so that all may see a light. What was previously there? Catch what I said there. The lifting up of a curtain so that all may see a light. That's us. Mm-hmm. We're all of Christ. And his revelation is for us all to see a light. His revelation. His glory. So to simply put, a is the unveiling of facts and truth that man cannot know himself.
Amen.
Well, we cannot know everything about God. Nor will we.
No, that's right.
But we know this. Jesus is revealing himself to us.
Yes.
He's made himself known unto us.
Mm-hmm.
And a revelation is that all may see a light. So the revelation of his glory, the revelation of his holiness, it's not just for you as an individual, but for us as a church.
Amen.
And so in order for us to see the presence of God, it is no longer us as a singular of holiness, but as a plural of holiness.
Mm-hmm.
For no holiness as a body is no presence of God. That is what his revelation reveals to us. And so here's two important facts. Two very important aspects of the revelation of his holiness. Number one is a very important aspect of Christianity, to walk in his holiness.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And number two, we're able to behold him in a way that the world cannot. But without beholding the Lord, we cannot be transformed into his likeness.
Right.
Without beholding the Lord, we cannot behold him. And so Jesus, he walked holy. And he gave, or God gave him the disciples to reveal the nature and characteristics of God too. And that's the same to us. But yet if we do not walk in his holiness, if we do not behold the Lord, we cannot be holy.
Right.
And without holiness, his presence is not with us.
Right.
And without the presence of the Lord, we cannot see him. And others cannot see him. There will be no change. For we must be ever changing in his character and in his nature. For in order for us to see revival, in order for us to have that number changed, we must be changing evermore.
Amen.
We cannot be stalemate.
Amen.
We cannot be still. For whoever has my commands, this is John chapter 14, verse 21. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself unto them. John chapter 15, verses 5 and 6. I am the vine, you are the branches. Remain in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Yep. Apart from me, you can do nothing. For if you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire. Yep. A little more teaching here. The word fruit in this context means the manifestation of the nature of God.
Wow.
That is his fruit. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. So you will bear the manifestation of the nature of God.
Yeah.
And if we take the root of manifestation, which is manifest, it means to make clear or to make evident to the eye, or to make clear or evident to understand. Simply, it means to show plainly. And so to look even further to the Greek, emphanizil, it is used for the word manifest, which means to make apparent, cause to be seen, cause to show. And so he's calling us to manifest his nature, to manifest his glory, to make apparent, to cause to be seen, cause to be seen, and cause to show. To make clear and to make evident the nature of God. It is not a complicated thing. The nature of God is not meant to be complicated.
No.
And when we make it complicated, that's when we don't see his glory. That's when we don't see his presence. Because if we start to make things complicated, we are no longer making it about God, but we're trying to make our own God. Trying to place their own thought into it. For God, whenever he presented his word, he made it simple. He made the Bible as simple as he could. For if he would have made it complicated, though, then why would he write it? For that wouldn't be a good thing for God to do. I mean, think about it. If God made the word complicated, then we're supposed to understand it. That's a cruel job. That's like school for life. I'm in school now and I already don't like it. Now think about that for eternity. Or for the rest of your life. Trying to figure out what God is trying to call you to do. But yet he's making it so simple to us. He's revealing it to us. And that is how it's always supposed to be. And so, we are to reveal the manifestation of his glory to others. We find this in Exodus chapter 33. Another example of Moses. Exodus chapter 33, verse 15. Then Moses said to him, if your presence does not go with us, that is to the promised land, do not send us from
our right.
So God is speaking to Moses in this passage. You can read a little bit of verses ahead. And Moses and God have really interesting encounters. Really interesting encounters. Through a bush is one of the more common ones. But what about God speaking to Moses face to face? For we read earlier in Exodus chapter 19 that Moses prepared himself, consecrated himself to meet God. And in verse 11 in Exodus chapter 33, it tells us that God, that Moses is speaking to God face to face, just like I am with you today. And now, God has blessed the Israelites with the promises. Already promised it to him. All they had to do was go. And then he called Moses to lead. And Moses has the audacity to say, if your presence does not go with us, do not send us from here.
Yeah.
So he's telling God, God, you blessed the Israelites. You blessed them. But I don't want them. If you Your presence doesn't go with us.
Yeah.
Good.
I don't want your blessing.
Yeah, his presence.
I want your presence. For this is a promise God has already given the Israelites. And Moses is saying, it's not enough. Your blessing, God, is not enough. I can have that however much I want it. You promised it to me. You've given me promises. You told me I was going to lead these people to the promised land. But God, I don't want it unless I have your presence. And he even goes as far to say this. In verse 18. Now, show me your glory.
Yeah.
Show me your glory. That is how important the holiness of God is. How important the presence of God is to Moses. God, I don't want your blessings if I don't have your presence. And God, I want your glory. Show it to me. This is what he asked for. And so now let me ask you, how important is his presence to you? Are his blessings lower than your desire for his presence? Or are you stuck living your Christian walk in which you benefit off of his blessings more than you do your presence, than his presence? Because if that is the case, the presence of God will never be revealed to you. For yes, he offers us his presence. He makes that known to us. But the desire of his presence must be greater than the desire of his blessings. For Moses longed to see God's presence. He longed to see his glory. He even asked for it. And you look, and you continue reading. God says, listen, my glory is too much for any man. You could die for my glory, but I won't do this for you. Though you will not see my face, you will see a glimpse of my glory. And God gave this to Moses. He showed his glory to Moses. And here we find the meaning of Matthew chapter 7, verse 3. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. So Moses sought God's glory. Where do we find what we seek? And we find that in Exodus chapter 33, verse 18. I'll show you your glory. And in the verses that follow. We find that in his presence. So how do we get to his presence? We find that in Matthew 7, 7 and 8. Seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, the door will be open. So how do we get to his presence? We knock. We knock on the door to his presence. For he's already made it known to us that he's going to reveal it to us. That his presence is revealed to us. And if you want it, you can have it. You got to knock. You got to consecrate yourself. You have to prepare yourself. Prepare yourself to meet the Lord. And when you do that, and you put his presence over his blessings, you have it. But when you knock, you have to come to him home.
Yes.
You see, with Moses, whenever he asked God, let me have your presence, let me have your glory. He did it denying his blessings. Saying, God, I'll give these blessings up. Mm-hmm. I'll give myself up. I'll give up my promises. Because I want your presence. And so when he does this, he's revealing, Moses is that the presence of God is one of the most important things that we can have.
Right. Yes.
And we should approach God in this manner. That God, I present myself humbly to you, for I want you, God. And not only do I want you, I need you. I want your glory, I want your presence, but I need it. I need it more than your blessings.
Yeah.
For he's already seen God's face. He's already seen his presence on the mountain. He's already seen his cloud. He's already heard his voice. But the glimpse of it isn't enough. For he wants more. Church, how much more do we want?
Come on.
Are we satisfied by what we see on Sundays?
Yes.
Or do we want more? Because if you're not satisfied, then why are you sitting in the pew? If you're not satisfied, why are you not fasting? If you're not satisfied, why are you not pursuing? Why are you not pursuing the holiness of God? For Moses, after he was given the commands of both Exodus chapter 19 and Exodus 33, he was to go down to the people. He was to come up off the mountain. Moses could have stayed in his presence. God gave it to him. He could have stayed. But Moses knew that he had to prepare the hearts of the people. For that is what God had given him. He had given him the plan, the goal, the mission, to consecrate the people that they might see his presence. So when we see the presence of God on Sundays and on Wednesdays, we are to also carry it out.
That's right.
And carry it out then.
That's right.
To your workplace.
That's right.
To your community.
Mm-hmm.
To your school.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever you may roam. Wherever you may go, that is where you're supposed to be. That is where you depart to bring his presence. For he revealed his commands to Moses, for the Israelites to obey his commands. To obey his commands and be consecrated. And so Moses knew that in order to prepare the presence of God, he had to be changed in character, in truth, and in behavior.
Amen. Yes.
So if we look at the Hebrew word, the Jesus, this is a word for holy. We find that it reveals a behavior that is pure, sinless, and upright. But this behavior cannot be done by man. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, it says, whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. So we have the command to live just as Jesus did. For our target is to not sin, but our goal is to live as Jesus did. And the only way we can live as Jesus did is by his grace.
Yes, that's right.
For that is why God presented himself to Moses. For he knew Moses could not lead the people on his own. He didn't have the strength to lead the people on his own. You take all that Moses had to go through with them, and you could simply put it and wonder how God deals with us.
Yes.
Think about it.
I mean, think about it. How much sin do you commit in your lifetime?
Mm-hmm.
How much sin do the Israelites commit? But yet, through God's grace, Moses was able to have the strength to lead the people.
That's right.
Through God's grace, Jesus was able to teach the disciples, to go around preaching the gospel. So what is grace? The Greek Charis, it means gift, benefit, favor, gracious, and liberality. So in common words, this is unmerited favor. That's right. That's correct. But it's not all of it. The definition continues, and it says, it is described also as the divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in the life. So not only do we have favor, but we are also to have influence with that favor. Mm-hmm. And it's supposed to reflect in our life. And so, you erase this. Wow, that's bad.
You have to spray it first.
I'll try. And I'm doing my best to pass the exam presentation. Writing all these questions. Grace equals empowerment.
Yes.
That is what grace is. To reveal this, we'll go to Romans chapter 5, verse 2. And it says, through whom we have gained access into this grace in which we now stand. So we've gained access by faith into this grace. And so now, if we go to James chapter 2, verse 18, now I'll read it off the screen. So once I read it off the screen, we can make the connection. James chapter 2, verse 18. Ye, a man, say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. For we have gained access by faith into this grace. So let's take this faith. And because of Romans 5, 2, we can replace faith with grace. That reads this. He, a man, may say, thou hast grace, and I have works. Show me thy grace without thy works, and I will show thee my grace by my works. So we are to show the grace of God in our lives by what we do.
Yes.
Revealing what grace is. The divine influence upon the heart and the reflection in the life. And so grace should now become more evident to us that it is empowerment for us to spread His holiness. For grace is the gateway to His holiness, and holiness is the gateway to His presence.
Yes, yes, wow.
And so, if we don't show His grace, then how can we walk in holiness? We can't. We need His grace. And if we look at the first mention of grace, we find it in John chapter 1, verse 16. John chapter 1, verse 16, the first mention of grace in the Bible. Out of His fullness, we have all received grace in place of grace already. For we have received grace upon grace. What does that mean? So, if you open up this verse and you look at the Greek of it, I'm going to paraphrase this verse. And this is what it means. John chapter 1, verse 16 states this. The overflow, or the abundance of what grace does for us, is that it gives us the fullness of Christ. So God introduced His grace to us and partake of it, and that we may receive the fullness of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. For that is how we are to walk. For 1 John chapter 4, verse 17, in this world we are to be like Jesus. And it is by grace that we are able to do so. It is by grace that we are to do so, and that we are to walk like Jesus, that we are to walk in holiness. For it's Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 says this, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self. When we skip to verse 24, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and in holiness. So we were created to walk pure, sinless, upright behavior. We are to walk in the Jesus. And because we are able to walk in that manner, we are able to see the presence of God. And so how do we walk in the presence of God? My brother Wes mentioned Sunday morning, we have to take off the grave clothes.
Yes.
We have to break off those chains of bondage. We have to lift those burdens. Because if we keep walking in those, walking with those, we can't walk in holiness. We'll be weighted down. We won't have the strength to continue. But we'll have the strength if we give it to God.
Amen. Yes.
And once we give ourselves wholly to God, just as Moses did on the mountain, we'll see the presence of God. And when we see the presence of God, we're able to walk just like Jesus did. Amen. And because we're able to walk just like Jesus did, we're able to see the benefits of His presence. For when we yield to His holiness, we see His blessings. Because we see His presence. For Psalm chapter 15, verses 1 and 2 tells us this. Lord, who may dwell in your sacred tent? Who may live on your holy mountain? The one whose walk is blameless. The one who does what is righteous. So we can say we're a Christian all we want to. We can. But if your life isn't reflecting grace, the empowerment of grace, reflecting holiness, if it's not reflecting His presence, then who are you to say that you're a Christian? You see, I can present it to you any way you want me to. I can sugarcoat it any way that you want me to. But no matter how I do it, the truth is always going to be the truth. If you're not walking like Jesus did, you're not going to see His presence.
That's right.
For being holy, like I mentioned, is an important aspect of the foundation of God's reign. And His reign is in us. For He's revealed His true nature, His true self, His true character to us. He's revealed that holiness to us. And if we are not revealing it to others, then we're not doing our part. For we are living in a fallen world. We have a pastor and the mother of a pastor. But we're in a different continent right now. Preaching the word to people who are living lost, who are living dying, who need God, who now have a desire for God. Why? Because they're revealing the true nature of God through them. They're revealing their desire for God's presence to them. And because they're consecrated, the people of Togo was seeing the miracles, the signs, and the wonders of the presence of God. And each and every single Monday, or Sunday, not Monday, but it should be Monday, too. We ask for God's presence. We ask that God's presence be evident in these parts. And He gives us a glimpse of it.
Yeah.
He gives us a glimpse of His presence. But there's more.
Yeah.
Why do you think God wants us to fast? Why do you think Pastor has devotedly asked us to fast? To humble ourselves before God, that we may seek His face, that we may seek His glory, that we may seek His holiness, that others may yield to, that they might see it, that they might be saved, that revival may come. For Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, for the grace of God appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, godly in the present age. For this was not a command just for those in biblical times. This is Paul writing to Titus, a young minister in his own right, an armor bearer for Paul, to live upright, godly, now. And we want to see souls saved. We want to see lives changed. We want to see revival. And we have to live it now. We can't live for February 16th. We can't live for it until the fast is over. We can't live for it after the revival. We have to live for it now. We have to prepare ourselves for the revival now. For I read this quote in this book I was reading, and it struck me. It struck me really hard as I was reading it, because it spoke so much truth. And it was, I took it as a command. And I want to give this command to y'all tonight. For we declare rightly that it, which is grace, that it saves, forgives, and is a free gift of His love. However, we must not forget to declare that it has changed our very nature and empowers us to not live as we used to. Church, we can't take grace for granted.
That's right.
We can't. For we must tell others that they're now empowered, for they have received grace to forsake ungodly behavior. For if we don't, then we and they miss out on His presence. And if we miss out on His presence, then we miss out on His revival. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep.
And we have a saying around here: as goes Bell's Chapel, as goes the City of Athens. As goes the City of Athens, as goes Pope County. As goes Pope County, as goes the River Valley. As goes the River Valley, as goes the State of Arkansas.
That's right.
And as goes the State of Arkansas, as goes the nation. And the revival for all of us starts with us. Before we say it starts with Adams Bell's Chapel, but I want to take it one step ahead. As goes you.
That's right.
As goes you. Because this church, it's just a building.
Right.
You make the church.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a church without you.
That's right.
We can't put all the weight on our pastor.
That's right.
Or the leaders of the church. Or our associate pastor. Or our deacons. Or the Sunday school teachers. We can't place the burden on them. You have to take action yourself.
That's right.
For I spoke to you earlier that grace is the influence upon the life and the reflection of the life. So in that, grace is an action. And it's an action for you to take.
Mm-hmm.
So when we yield to His grace, we yield to Him. And when we yield to Him, we yield to His presence. We yield to His holiness. And thus we see. So church, I come to you tonight in love to quote Isaiah's response to God. For he recognized that he was unholy, that he needed God. And God forgave him and made him clean. In Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, it says this, "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And Isaiah said this, "Here I am, God. Send me." So tonight, who are you? Who are you? Are you walking in His holiness? Are you walking in His grace? Are you walking in His mercy and His love? In any characteristic of God, are you walking in it? Because He's calling you. He's calling you to be the flame, to be the spark of the revival. And it's not just the one. It's not just the one pastor. It's not just the one deacon. It's not just the one individual that He's calling. But He's calling all of us.
That's right.
He's calling all of us. But we are to take off the greater clothes, to walk off the mountain, and to pursue His holiness.
That's right.
So tonight, church, if you are not fasting, I pray that you. I challenge you to. Because if we want to see revival, if we want to see the presence of God like never before, the only way we can see it is if we humble ourselves. And if we can't humble ourselves to fast for God, to give up something for God, then we are taking His blessings over His presence.
That's
simply keep it.
That's right.
When we say we all need to be in one mind and one accord, and to be in one mind will mean this. To be in one mind means to earnestly seek His presence.
Come on.
And to take it over His blessings.
Yes.
But we saw a spiritual move in Acts. And how did that happen? It didn't happen because they took His blessings. It happened because they took His presence. And so, church, in closing, I didn't speak for no hour. I didn't speak as long as Pastor Chad did or does. But I did do this. I came here tonight to challenge you.
Amen.
To give you this word. And to say this. To warn you. If you're not living holy, it's time to start.
That's right.
If you're not walking in His grace, it's time to start.
That's right.
If you have chains, if you have bondage that you're walking in and then you're holding on to, it's time to let it go.
Mm-hmm.
It's time to take off the grave clothes.
Come on.
Trash.
Come on.
That's where it belongs.
That's right.
For God has given me power, He's given me authority.
Yeah.
Same as each and every single one of you.
That's right.
To look at Satan. Yes. And to stop His head.
Right.
So tonight, church, I'm done. I'm going to pray this out. But with this, don't leave here the same. He's called you for so much more. And He promises us so much more. So church, be ready. Consecrate yourselves. Prepare yourselves. Because revival is coming. Revival is coming. And it starts with you. So Father, we love you and we praise you. We just thank you for all that you do for us and for all that you've done for us. God, I just ask that you would just put your hand upon each and every one of us. And God, help us to seek your grace. To seek your holiness. For God, without your holiness, without your grace, we don't have the strength to do anything. For we can't see your face without your grace, without your holiness. But God, let us leave this place chainless. Let us leave this place with the bondage broken off of us, God, that we may walk in your holiness, that we may walk in your truth, that we may walk in your power. For that's what your word is. Father, let us recognize that your blood is more than enough. And let us never take for granted your grace. For God, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your holiness. And Father, as Isaiah said, God, here I am, send me. Let that be our call tonight now. To say, God, I will humble myself like Moses did on the mountain. For your presence means more to me than your blessings. For God, I want your presence. I want you, God. And I want you more and more. So God, let us leave this place changed with a new perception. With a new desire. That desire to see you. To seek your face in Jesus' name. God bless each and every single one of you. Remember, if you can be here Saturday, meet with Sister Christy, Pastor Christy on that, on the time that you can be here. Other than that, God bless you all, and if there's no other announcements, you are dismissed.
In Jesus' name.